Welcome our YouTube friends. I want to welcome our YouTube friends to First Congregational Church. We're turning in our Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 18. The children have just gone downstairs, and what we want to do is we want to invite the Holy Spirit to open up our hearts to understand what God's Word would have us for this day. So let's pray. Father, I thank you for Jesus, and I thank you for your word, and I thank you for the Holy Spirit, and I thank you, Father, for you being our Father. And Lord, we thank you for the life that you've given us. Life with you is good. You said that you've come to give us life and life abundantly. And Lord, I know sometimes we quench your spirit and we block the abundant life. And I pray, God, that you would forgive us for that and help us not to quench the Holy Spirit, but that we would walk in the Spirit, Father, that we would enjoy the presence of the Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit, we invite you into this place to open up the Scriptures to our understanding, that we would see and hear what you would have us to see and hear, and that you would also give us the hearts to receive, that we can, because Lord, we don't want to just be seers of the word. We want to be doers of the word, or just hearers of the word. We want to be doers of the word. And so, Father, I pray, God, that you would help us to take what you would have for us in this passage and implement it into our lives and use it to glorify you and to minister to others. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Title of my message is The Day of Decision. I didn't tell Lynn what the title of my sermon was, and much of what we sang talks about making a decision for God. And I want you to know that's part of the Holy Spirit's moving through the body together, that we are all connected by the Holy Spirit. If you're born again, if Jesus Christ is in your heart, then you're connected to me through the Holy Spirit. We're one body, and Jesus Christ is the head. We're all connected. And that's why going to church is important, because what would happen to you if you chopped off a finger? You'd bleed. It hurts. And you'd be less effective, okay? And that's why every member of the church is important. And that's why the Bible says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. And you know what? I'm sorry, I'm on this. This is a freebie. This is Holy Spirit led. You know, people who go to church on a regular basis tend to be more healthy than people who don't. It's a scientific fact. Okay? And of course, there are probably reasons for that. Maybe one is we're not out getting into things we're not supposed to be getting into, and that adds some years to our lives. But I think it's more than that. I think it's when we spend time under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Yes, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Wherever we go, there's the Holy Spirit. Okay? But there's a special anointing that comes upon the people of God when they assemble together. And that's spelled out in the Old Testament, where the psalmist says, one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. We got way more than two here. So how much can we put to flight? And just think, if we kept adding more people, it exponentially goes up, the power that, you know, of God flowing through God. See, because God's a gentleman. He will not force his power upon anyone until the time of his wrath. When the day of his wrath comes, then people will see his power and they won't like it. And, you know, and of course, we're not going to be a part of that, praise God. But anyways, all right, day of decision. 1 Kings chapter 18, we're going to start in verse 20. Verse 20, it says, so Ahab sent for all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together on Mount Carmel. And Elijah came to all the people and said, how long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him. But the people answered him not a word. And then Elijah said to the people, I alone am left a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. Therefore, let them give us two bulls, and let them choose one bull for themselves, cut it in pieces, lay it on the wood, put no fire under it, and I will prepare the other bull and lay it on the wood, but put no fire under it. Then you call upon the name of your gods, and I will call upon the name of the Lord, and the God who answers by fire, he is God. So the people answered and said, it is well spoken. Now Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose one bull for yourselves, prepare it first, for you are many, and call upon the name of your God, but put no fire under it. So they took the bull, which was given them, and they prepared it, and called on the name of Baal from morning till noon, saying, O Baal, hear us. But there was no voice. No one answered. Then they leaped about the altar which they had made. And so it was at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, cry aloud, for he is God. Either he's meditating, or he's busy, or he's on a journey, or perhaps he's sleeping. He must be awakened. So they cried aloud and cut themselves, as it was their custom, with knives and lances until the blood gushed out of them. And when the midday was past, they prophesied until the time of the evening sacrifice. But there was no voice. No one answered. No one paid attention. Then Elijah said to all the people, come near to me. So all the people came near to him, and he prepared the altar of the Lord, which had been broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, to whom the word of God had come, saying, Israel shall be your name. Then with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench around the large altar, large enough to hold 2 selahs of seed. And he put the wood in the order, and he cut the bull in pieces and laid it on the wood, and said, fill 4 water pots with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. And then he said, do it a second time, and they did it a second time. And he said, do it a third time, and they did it a third time, so that the water ran all around the altar, and he also filled the trench with water. And it came to pass, at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and I am your servant, and I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, O Lord, hear now this people, that they may know that you are the Lord God, and that you have turned their hearts back to you again. Then fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust, and it licked up the water that was in the trench. Now when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. And Elijah said to them, seize the prophets of Baal. Do not let any one of them escape. So they seized them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook of Kishron and executed them there. Awesome. Title of my message, I said before, is The Day of Decision. If you were to read the several chapters before this event, Israel was at a very tough time in her history. Elijah, his name means, the Lord is my God. And he was a prophet to the northern kingdom. The northern kingdom is most often referred to as Israel or Ephraim. Okay, and he ruled the northern, and he was a prophet sent to the king Ahab, and Ahab ruled the northern kingdom, and Elijah was a prophet to the northern kingdom. There was also a southern kingdom. That southern kingdom is also called Israel sometimes, but most of the time it's called Judah. Okay, and the southern kingdom was the more righteous of the two kingdoms of Israel. Okay, in the northern kingdom, there wasn't a single good king. They started out on bad, and they got worse and worse and worse. And their judgment was, the Assyrians came in and took them captive in the seventh century before Jesus Christ was born. Okay, I think 750 or something. I'm not sure the exact date. I have to go back and look on. But the northern kingdom went into captivity almost 120 to 150 years before the southern kingdom. The southern kingdom had some good kings, mostly not good kings. And the southern kingdom also ends up going into judgment. And it's the Babylonians who conquer the southern kingdom. But we're going to focus in on the northern kingdom today, because that was the focus of Elijah's ministry. And Elijah was sent to the northern kingdom because they were not worshiping the one true God. In fact, they were worshiping everything else. They were worshiping the Baals and the Ashtoreths and all the foreign and false gods. And we look at this stuff and we kind of smirk. Oh, those silly, superstitious people. Why would they worship idols? Well, I'm here to tell you, there was something behind these idols. They weren't just worshiping stone, although they were, okay? The demonic was playing a role in the false worship. And there are passages in the Old Testament where the demonic tries to supernaturally overwhelm the people of God. And of course, it always loses, because greater is he who is in us than he was in the world, okay? But Elijah was sent, and his name means the Lord is my God. And we know from the scriptures that Elijah prayed that it would not rain. And it didn't for 3.5 years. Okay? And you know what? The Old Testament doesn't tell us the time. It's actually the New Testament. The book of James tells us that Elijah prayed and it wouldn't rain for 3.5 years. And Jesus tells us that Elijah prayed and it didn't rain for 3.5 years. And it's interesting that it's 3.5 years. God seems to deal with 3.5 year increments with Israel a lot, okay? And for those of you who've done any time of end time study, you know what I'm talking about. The last half of the tribulation is called the Great Tribulation, and it's 3.5 years long. I don't think that's a coincidence. I think God is trying to get the attention of mankind. And I think God's trying to get the attention of even his people, Israel, and also his church. The nation of Israel at this time was enslaved by bondage to false gods. And Elijah was sent by God to make Israel face a decision. Who are you going to serve? Now you're saying, well, this is nice now. So you're talking about Old Testament people. You know, we're not in that dispensation. You know, what's the big deal? Why are you bringing us into this passage? Well, for two reasons. First, there's a scriptural reason. All scripture is God-breathed and profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for all works of good service. All scripture, not just the New Testament, not just my favorite passages or your favorite passages, the whole thing. The whole thing. Okay? And one of the reasons why I believe the church falls into so many ridiculous things is because we don't really study the whole thing. We don't really study. We only study the parts we like. We pick and choose like we're at some kind of buffet. Oh, I like the prophets, but I don't like Judges. Oh, I like Revelation, but I don't like Matthew. Oh, I like the Gospel of John. No. It's all God breathed.
Amen.
But you know what? As an individual Christian, you too face a day of decision. And guess what? The day of decision is every day of your life.
Amen.
As believers, are we saved? Yes. Do I believe that our salvation is secure? Absolutely. Jesus Christ is the author and finisher of our salvation. But the question is, are we serving God? And we have a day of decision. Every day that you wake up is a day of decision. Now, as a nation, days of decision come. And it usually takes a little bit longer because God is merciful. God allows nations to get away with stuff for long periods of time. In fact, if you study history, the average kingdom, republic, empire usually lasts about 250 years. And then it's done. We just celebrated our 240th birthday as a nation. Wow. Now, am I saying to you that we only have 10 years left? I'm not, because I'm not a prophet. I don't operate in the prophetic. Usually. Actually, I can operate in the prophetic, because anyone can operate in the prophetic. Okay? But do I normally operate in the prophetic? No. You know, my gift is more evangelism, it's more teaching, it's more preaching. But I am, a junior historian. I won't call myself a major historian, because I don't know everything about history. But I do like history, and I do try to pay attention to history. And I believe that America has a day of decision. And I think that we're coming upon a day of decision, you know, and And so that we can tie this together, remember what God's word says in 2 Chronicles 7:14. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. God said that to Israel, and Israel is in a day of decision here. Elijah the prophet has brought to them a decision, a turning point. If Baal is God, let's serve him. But if Jehovah is God, then let us serve him. Let's stop going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Serving God, the real God, some days, and serving the false God some other days. And I believe as Christians, sometimes we do that. We vacillate. We sometimes serve our own desires. We almost prop ourselves up as a little God, you know, and instead of saying, well, Lord, what do you want for me today? How can I serve you today? My thesis is this: let us come to the altar of the Lord and worship him. Amen. You see, I can preach to you till I'm blue in the face. I can give you biblical exposition till the cows come home. I can exhort you, admonish you. I could even scold you. I could hug you. There's all kinds of things I could do. But you know what? Unless you are worshiping God, I don't think there's much I could do to move you in doing the things that God wants you to do. I think that we need to be worshipers of the Most High God on a daily basis. I believe that Israel lost her way because of political expediency. Remember I talked about how the nation had been divided into two? You had the northern kingdom of Israel, the southern kingdom of Judah. What happened was, after Solomon, was Rehoboam. And Rehoboam had the people came to him and said, Rehoboam, your dad was hard on us. If you will just back off, we'll serve you. And the advisors of Solomon, his father, the old guys, said, yeah, that's good. Listen to the people. If you listen to the people, they will serve you your whole life. But see, he had his own generation with him as well, the young bucks. And you know what the young buck said to him? You tell those people, you think my dad was tough? I'm 10 times tough. I'm paraphrasing, obviously. Okay? And tell them, you're going to work harder for me than you ever did for your father. And the people said, what do we have with David and his family? We're out of here. And so they left. Under the leadership of Jeroboam. Jeroboam was the first king of the northern kingdom. And Jeroboam realized something. See, God had made it very clear in his word, there's only one place where you could offer up sacrifices and worship the Lord God in the Old Testament. Let me pause there for a moment. We should be so excited that we live in a New Testament covenant.
Amen.
Do you realize that if this was the Old Testament, what we're doing right now would be illegal? This would be illegal. If we were going to be obedient according to the Old Testament covenant, we would have to go to Israel, we would have to go to Jerusalem, we'd have to go into the temple, and we would have to offer up lambs and pigeons and bulls and goats and grain offerings, and we could only do that in Jerusalem, and we would have to go there for Passover, and we'd have to go there for Shabbat, and we'd have to go all the seven feasts of Moses, and then they added two more because of Esther's ministry, okay? And so that would be the way of worship. But you know what? In this New Testament covenant, guys, we can worship Jesus Christ right here. Amen. Because Jesus said to the Samaritans who were arguing with the Jews over where you should worship, he said, there's going to come a day when my Father in heaven will seek those who do not worship him on this mountain or that mountain, but those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. As long as we worship God in spirit and in truth, we can worship him anywhere.
Amen.
And that's incredible. But you know what? We're so used to it. It has become so mundane. Ooh, I'm here to worship the Lord. I'm so bored worshiping the Lord. Bunch of Eeyores, you know, worshiping the Lord. Man, we should be rocking the house.
Amen.
You know, and I know that I know, there's a time to be quiet. I get that. I'm a spaz. When I worship, I'm spazzy when I worship God. Okay, that's just my style. Some of you are a little more, you know, it's not the style, it's the heart. It's the heart. Okay?
Yes.
And Israel had a heart problem. They had a heart problem. And so the prophet lays down the challenge. That's my first point. The challenge. And the challenge, we read what the challenge was. He says, look, you have the prophets of Baal. You have the Lord God. I'm the only prophet of the Lord left. Okay? Elijah was a little bit full of himself. He's going to find out a little bit later that there's still other people who are worshiping. So don't think you're the only one.
That's right.
You're not the only one worshiping God. Okay? Right? God always has a remnant. Always. Okay? But anyways, he says, and maybe he was the only prophet at the time. I don't know. I haven't researched it enough to tell for sure. But he says, I'm the only prophet left of the Lord. Okay? Baal's got 450 prophets. You know what? I challenge them. I like Elijah, though. The guy has, you know? Chutzpah. Chutzpah. Yeah. Thank you. He has chutzpah. And so he says, look, you 450 prophets, you go get a bull, you build an altar, you put wood on it, but don't put fire. You cry out to your God, ask him to call down fire. And you go first. And so they do. They accept the challenge. He says, and then after you do that, I will do the same thing. I will build an altar in the name of the Lord God of Israel with 12 stones. Each stone representing a tribe of Israel. And whatever God sends fire down, he is God. And that's who we're going to worship. You realize what Elijah is doing here. He is putting his own life on the line. Because if the fire doesn't come down for him, and it does come down for Baal, if God should allow a demon spirit to deceive Israel to worship, of course, that's not really God's way, but if it were possible, Elijah would have been a dead man. Because they'd have like, see, Baal's God, let's kill the blasphemer. See, because guys, you know what? In America, you can't offend anyone anymore. You hurt someone's feelings, you're a bad person. Well, you know what? I don't really care about people's feelings compared to babies dying in a womb.
Amen.
Or people's feelings compared to our young men and women shedding their blood on a foreign battlefield, and then our politicians throw away the gains that these brave young men and women have gained for us. Okay. Now, I do care about feelings. I don't want to hurt people's feelings on purpose. I don't attempt, it's not my goal in life to hurt people's feelings, but there needs to be some perspective. I think the blood of babies and the blood of our men and women and other things that are important to our nation are a little more important than if someone's feelings are hurt. Because wouldn't it be better to have a prosperous and godly nation with some people with hurt feelings than to have an ungodly nation that is going to turn into a junk hole as long as their feelings are not hurt? I'm sorry. Maybe that makes me a mean guy. All right, I'll take it. So be it. So be it. But the question is, in the challenge, who will you follow? But the question to us is, who will we follow?
Amen.
Will we serve the Lord? Will we answer his call? I know a little bit something about callings. I ran from my calling. But I'm here to tell you, you cannot run from your calling. If you belong to Jesus Christ, if you are one of his sheep, and he calls you to do something, you can run, but you cannot hide. The hounds of heaven will find you. They will not leave you alone until you finally say, not my will, Lord, your will be done.
Amen.
And I think part of the big problem with the church in America is a lot of Christians are running from their call. They're running away from their call. And I don't know what your call is. So don't be thinking, oh, well, pastor doesn't know, I'm not, you know, doing my call and he's picking on me and I'm, stop it, pastor. Because I don't know. Yeah, do you hurt my feelings? Too bad. I want you obedient to God.
Amen.
What does it profit a man? Right? To gain the world. I mean, you could stop right there. I mean, don't get me wrong. I believe that we should try to be successful. I don't think we should work for failure. I don't think that we should, you know, I think we should put up, you know, the best, you know, whatever we find our hands doing, do as unto the Lord kind of thing. You know, work hard, you know, be a good worker, be a, you know, a person of integrity and stuff. But let's put things in perspective. A beautiful house, a boat, a sport car are nice things if God does add them to you. And I'm not against those things. But they shouldn't be our main pursuits either. The challenge is, will we serve God? Now, here's the problem. As you all know, I like it when one commentator on the radio says that he lives in Realville. Okay? I try to live in Realville. Okay, with, you know, this Christianity thing. There are some preachers that will tell you, accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You'll be successful and prosperous all the time. You'll never have any problems. Jesus is your best friend. It'll just be wonderful. You know, it'll just be daisies and, you know, and unicorns and fluffy kitty cats. And it'll just be so simple. And your business will prosper. And your children will love you. And you'll never get sick. That's not Realville. We live in a cursed and fallen world. We're in the midst of a war for the souls of men. And sickness does happen to believers. Ask Job. Bad things happen to believers. And a lot of believers, you know, they say, okay, well, I'm going to serve God until the bad things start happening. And then they say, oh, that's it, I'm done. Where is God? You know, I gave him my life. I put myself in his care. And now all these bad things are happening. Why should I serve God? There were some missionaries who had the answer when they went to Ecuador and were killed by cannibalistic Indians. And their leader, and I'm going to mess up this quote, so I apologize from the beginning, but he said something to this effect of, it is better to, I'm not going to get it, but basically, I'm going to give you a paraphrase. He basically said, what does it profit me to lose what I can't keep?
He is no fool who gets what he cannot keep, gain that which he cannot lose.
There you go. Because, you know what? When we die, everybody dies the same way. They take your body, they put you in a pine box, or they put you in a furnace. They burn you up or they bury you. Doesn't matter if you're a billionaire or a pauper, we all die the same way. Death is no respecter of persons. You're not going to take your boat and your car and your big house and your money with you to heaven. Okay? You know? But if you're born again, you don't see death. You don't see death. What do you mean? Christians die. Christians die, but they don't die. Because the moment a Christian closes their eyes in this life for the first time is the first day that they open their eyes in eternity. They don't see death. Death takes the body, but can't touch their spirit, their soul, because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So the believer will never die. We will never die. Jesus said that. He said, if you believe in me, though you die, yet you shall live. I never understood that until I heard a preacher explain that to me, and I'm like, oh yeah, that makes sense. When we close our eyes here for the last time, we open our eyes in eternity for the first time.
Amen.
That's awesome.
Yes.
Sure enough is.
But let me tell you something. Evil is calling as well, and that's my second point. Evil is calling. You notice that the prophets of Baal didn't get all intimidated and go, we're going to go away now. No. They do what they do. Okay? And they build their altar. They put their bull on it. They don't put the fire on it. They start chanting. They start crying out. They start calling to their gods. And they're calling out to their gods. And they're calling out to their gods. And they're calling out to their gods. And nothing. Because that's what the passage says. Nothing happens. No one answered. No one said anything. And about noontime... This is another reason why I like Elijah. He starts poking him. Maybe your God's sleeping. You've got to scream louder. Or actually, the New King James doesn't even do this justice. In the Old King James, it mentions him going to the bathroom. Like maybe he's down on the potty, okay? And you gotta yell louder so that he can hear you, you know? Or whatever. But Elijah starts mocking. Starts mocking these guys. And what does evil do? Back down? No, they double down and they start cutting themselves and hacking themselves and dancing louder and dancing harder. And you know what? Sometimes the devil will double down on you. You get cancer and then all of a sudden you lose your house. Or you're a businessman and your business fails, and then the IRS wants to put liens against you or something, or whatever. And so many times we think, well, I prayed that God would deliver me from this, and what happened? You know, I can only imagine maybe the people that weren't worshiping, you know, the Baals were like, why doesn't God just take these guys out? Why is he letting them do their thing? Why is the prophet of God letting them do this? This is evil. I don't want to see this. I don't want to hear this. I don't know. I'm just thinking of some emotions that goes through the human heart. And Satan has a call upon your life. Satan has a kingdom for you. And Satan has a form of worship that he wants you to follow. Now you think, come on, Nelson. People are going to worship Satan and the devil? Yeah. Yeah. Do you realize that, you know, well, okay, all right, maybe the ignorant and the uneducated would worship Satan. No, do you know that some of the most educated people in this country, they're corporate executives, they're politicians, they're people of great stature and wealth and power, they literally do worship the devil. They seek out the devil for guidance. We have Christian senators and congressmen that tell us this. There's a large group of our nation's leaders, and I believe that's why evil is so successful in this country, even though this country has been based upon the Judeo-Christian ethic and Judeo-Christian law and based upon the Bible. The reason why they're so effective is because they have a power behind them. And if you don't think the devil is real, and if you don't think that there's satanic power, you're deluding yourself. You're absolutely deluding yourself. And if you don't think Satan has a call in your life, you're deluding yourself. You know what Satan's motto is? Do unto others before they do unto you. Yeah. Take what you can, give nothing back. You know? You deserve everything. And if you got to step on someone's head to get there, stab them in the back to get there, then you do what you got to do. Because you know what? There is no God. You're just an evolutionary mistake, an evolutionary accident. And so it's dog-eat-dog world, baby. But the funny thing is, you know, and I got this from a friend of mine who was a pretty good apologist, and he was confronting some Satanists who were complaining that injustice had been done to them. And he said, whoa, wait a minute. Your God is the God of injustice. When you get ripped off, you should get on your knees and say, all hail Satan, I've been stolen from. Because he's a thief. Or if you get murdered, you should, as you're dying, say, all hail Satan, I've been murdered. Because he's a murderer. Or if your business gets destroyed, you should be saying, all hail Satan, for my business has been destroyed, because he's a destroyer. Yeah. And when he gives you death, you should be happy, because that's the God you're serving. That's the covenant you've made. You've made a covenant with death. Satan has a plan. Now, obviously, Satan is slick. You know, Satan will tell you things. Well, you know, those Christians are a bunch of haters. They're narrow-minded. They have no place for immigrants. They have no place for people that are different from them. They're, you know, they have no place for anyone. That's not true. The nations that are governed by Christian principles are the most tolerant nations in the world. We allow Muslims to worship Allah in our country because we believe in freedom. We allow Hindus to worship the billion gods that they have, okay? Because we believe in freedom. We allow people to be atheists if that's what they choose to be, because we believe in freedom. But that doesn't mean that we have to agree with them. Just because I disagree with the atheist, disagree with the Muslim, disagree with the Hindu, disagree with Jehovah Witnesses, Mormons, whatever, doesn't mean that I don't believe in their right to believe in what they want to believe. Because you know what? The God I serve doesn't force himself on anybody. He says, choose. Joshua, at the end of his life, as Israel was preparing, you know, preparing to take possession of the land, and his life was coming to an end, he said, listen, Israel, choose this day whom you shall serve. But as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. And that's all I'm saying. My house is going to serve God. My house is going to preach the gospel. My people are going to try to change the Satanist, change the atheist, change the Hindu, change the Muslim. Not through our power, but through the holy power of Almighty God.
Amen.
As the Holy Spirit comes down upon them and convicts them of their sin. I'm sorry. When the Bible says something is a sin, it's a sin. You don't have to like it. You can disagree with it, but that's the viewpoint. And the answer that the world has had is we got to shut them up. We cannot let these Christians speak their speak. Why? Because Satan has a plan. He knows that God's word will not return void.
Amen.
That it will accomplish what it sets out to do. Does that mean that everyone will get saved? No. Sadly, no. Sadly, no. Most people are going to reject this message. Okay? The believers are always a remnant. We're always the smaller group than the non-believers. It's non-believers and believers. It's two groups. And the non-believing group is always the bigger group, even in America. Okay? But the thing is, us believers, we don't want to force Christianity upon anybody. And the reason why the world doesn't want God's word out in the public is because Satan knows that if God's word is preached, people get saved, lives get changed, transformed, renewed, and the abundant life comes in. Jesus said, truly you are my disciples if my words abide in you, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. The devil doesn't want you free. He wants you in bondage. He wants you fearful. He wants you, you know, broken down. He may want you rich and miserable. There have been many, well, Robin Williams. This guy was known around the world. Couldn't live with himself. I feel bad for Robin. You know, there are others, you know, the people that commit suicide. Why? You know, and let's be realistic. As tough as things might be right now, America's still the best country to live in the world, by far. Nobody around the world has what we have in the abundance that we have to the availability as many people that we have. But evil has a plan. We have a challenge. God's got an answer.
Amen.
That's my third point. And the most important point, the Lord has an answer. And the answer is Elijah repairs the altar of the Lord. If you're a backslidden Christian and you're carnal and you've broken down the altar of worship in your life, you know what? I challenge you to rebuild the altar to the Lord. Come to the Lord with your praise offerings and your sacrifices of praise. And guess what? The Bible says the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. And when you give the sacrifice of praise, the Lord inhabits that. You know what happens? Pretty soon the Holy Spirit starts giving you the Holy Spirit goosebumps, is what I call them. And you start to get excited. And guess what? Once you start getting excited, once you start getting into the Abba Father mode, you know what that is? That's worship. You have just gone from praise. This is praise. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. That's praise.
Yes.
But you know what worship is? Jesus, I love you with everything.
Amen.
You are my God. You are my life. You are my Lord. That's worship. My spirit crying out with the Holy Spirit. Abba, Father, which Abba, you know, Abba sounds so technical. You know what that is? That's daddy. That's what Abba means, daddy.
Yes.
It's the Hebrew form of daddy. So when you say, Daddy God, I love you.
Amen.
That's worship. Now, sometimes we have rough weeks, and that's why God gives us the sacrifice of praise mode. You're not always going to be happy. Life is going to hand you the pits sometimes. You don't always get the cherries. Sometimes you just get the pits. Okay? And you may come in here upset and say, I don't feel like worshiping God. That's when you give the sacrifice of praise.
Amen.
You rebuild the altar. Elijah rebuilt the altar of the Lord. He took the 12 stones, he put it together. Then he took 4 buckets of water and he poured it on the altar. And they did it once and he said, do it again. They took 4 more buckets of water and they poured it on the altar. And he said, do it again. And they took 4 more buckets of water and they poured it on the altar. And I'm sorry, I'm a supernaturalist. I see the hand of God in everything. And I look at how many times did he command them to pour the water? 3. How many buckets of water did they pour? 4. 3 times 4 is 12. How many stones did he put on the altar? 12. 12 is the number of God's government. 12 apostles, 12 tribes. And so God was reestablishing the government of God. He was using symbols to do it. But God isn't just the God of symbols. He is a God of power and of might as well. Because what happens? After Elijah mocks these false prophets. And let me tell you, that reminds me, folks, there are going to be false prophets trying to come into your life. How do you discern a false prophet? Well, if you get a check in your spirit, that, you know, but you got to be careful with that, because sometimes it might be your spirit and not the Holy Spirit that's giving you the check. So if you want to verify it for sure, you go to God's Word. And if someone's telling you something contrary to God's Word, don't listen to them. Now, we don't kill New Testament prophets for messing up. Okay? Because I do believe that there are people in the body of Christ who have the gift of prophecy. And I do believe that sometimes they get over exuberant. And their spirit is telling them something. And they think it's the Holy Spirit telling them something. Okay? I call these baby prophets. Okay? And they give you some misinformation. Does that mean we throw the ministry of the prophet out the door? Out the window? No. Because, you know, I'm sorry. I love my Baptist brothers, but there are Baptist people out there who say gifts of the Spirit, those supernatural ministries, they were only for the first century, and we're done with that because we have the complete Word of God. I'm sorry. First of all, God's Word never says that, and it's not true. Signs and visions and wonders have not ceased. They still happen in the body of Christ. They don't, you know, you notice they don't happen as much in America. You know why? Because we don't need them as much. But you go to the bush where you get sick and your only way of being healed is Jesus, miracles happen.
Amen.
And I'm not saying that the Africans have more faith than Americans, because America has done great things in the name of Jesus. There are many wonderful American Christians who have started foundations and organizations and who've preached the ministry and who've sent out missionaries and stuff. I'm not glorifying the people in the third world over the people in the Western world that have everything. No, God supplies all our needs. We have doctors. And so because we have doctors, We don't need God always to heal us. But actually, understand this. Doctors really don't heal us. They just assist. It's God who's still healing us.
Yes.
Okay? But anyways, Elijah builds an altar. And he tells the people, come. Come. And he prays. Father, Jehovah, show them you are God. Send your fire down upon this altar. Consume it. And it happens. The bull is burned, the wood is burned, the stones are burned, and the water is licked up. A fire of God comes from heaven. You might be saying, well, how come God doesn't do that today? Guess what? He's already done it. The fire of God is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Poured out on the day of Pentecost. Let me tell you something. The Spirit of God is a holy fire.
Yes.
And you know, one of the reasons why, as a pastor, I've dedicated this church to praying for our country in this election is because we need the fire of the Holy Spirit to come down upon the people of America, to come down on Americans' voters, because there are people that are lying to them, telling them things that are not true. They're going to lead to their destruction. And they need to know the truth. Do you think that the prophets of Baal were giving the people of Israel the truth? No, they were not. They were giving them lies. They were telling them to worship the false god. And what was the final destination if those Jews died worshiping Baal? Where would they go? To hell. And there are people in this country telling our kids lies. You're not made by God. You're made by a monkey or primordial ooze. There is no God. You're just a cosmic accident. You're not created in the image of God. There's no plan for your life. You make your own way. You do what you gotta do. And it's all up to you. No, it's not. You know what Jesus said to his disciples? He said, apart from me, you can do nothing.
Amen.
Does that mean that they couldn't do anything? They couldn't build, you know, shells? They couldn't, you know, do their job? No, that's not what he was talking about. What he was talking about is you can't do anything that's of eternal value without God. I don't need Jesus to hop in my truck and deliver fish. I can do that all by myself. I have no problems doing that. Well, sometimes I have problems. Sorry, Daryl. I'm not perfect. Okay? But if I want to make those fish deliveries count in the light of eternity, I need God's fire.
Amen.
Because you know what? You know what? I'm sorry. I just can't get away from the book of Revelation. But the end of the book of Revelation, you know what it says? It says, the Spirit and the Bride says, come. Do you realize that when, if you are a born-again Christian filled with God's Spirit, that when you walk into a room full of sinners, the Holy Spirit inside of you is telling them to come to Jesus?
That's it.
Even before you open your mouth and tell him you're a Christian. I've shared this testimony before. I'm sorry if it's a repeat for you, but it's good for me to remind you of these things. Before I pastored this church, when I was a younger man, I was a youth pastor, and I was bivocational. Actually, I'm still bivocational, not bipolar, bivocational. Okay? And I was an installation mechanic and a youth pastor. And I remember, you know, my boss says, okay, Nelson, I want you to go run this job down in Simsbury, Connecticut. You know, we haven't sent anyone there. Measure the pipe, get the footage that you need to get. Okay, yada, yada, yada. So I'm measuring the pipe, getting the footage that I need, counting the elbows and the 45s and stuff to get all the things that I need and stuff. And of course, being at the warehouse, I try to grab stuff, you know, because I have a truck with me, and grab what I can while I can. And I get to the job site, and I walk on the job site, and I'm looking at the pipes, and I'm, you know, measuring them with the pipe measurer, and I'm counting the elbows and the 45s. And all of a sudden, this young man my age, comes up to me and says, he's doing his work. He goes, so, how do you think the world's going to end? Those of you who know me, that's a hoot. So, wait a minute, you're asking me how I think the world's going to end? Oh, let me tell you how I think the world's going to end, said the spider to the fly, right? I mean, that's like a meatball right down the center plate. And so I started witnessing to him.
Amen.
And telling him about Jesus, and that he needed Jesus in his heart, and that Jesus is coming back for his church, and that there's going to be the Antichrist, and that he's going to deceive the world, and that you don't want to be a part of that deception. But more importantly, you want to make sure that you love Jesus Christ. And I found out that he had fallen under the influence of some Jehovah Witnesses. So he started debating me from a Jehovah Witness standpoint. And we got into talking about the Holy Spirit. Because you know what? I'm sorry. The Holy Spirit's important, Baptist people. Okay, a lot of Baptists are getting it, though. I don't want to think people think I'm beating up on the Baptists. You know, there's another whole new category that they've kind of like identified in Christianity. They call them Bapticostals.
Amen.
These are dyed-in-the-wool Baptists who are operating in the gifts of the Spirit. It's awesome. I love Bapticostals. I love my Baptists that don't believe in you know, the gifts too. I just love them. You know, they're wrong, but I love them. Okay. But anyways, so we started debating the Holy Spirit. And he was trying to tell me that, you know, well, he's just an impersonal force. I'm like, no, he's not. He's a person. The Holy Spirit's a person. He's not an impersonal force. Okay? And I said, you know what? How can you grieve an impersonal force? I can't grieve electricity. Right? I can't make electricity sad. But I can make the Holy Spirit sad. Which tells me two things. One, he's a person. Two, he loves me. Because you can't grieve someone who doesn't love you. And so, and he said, well, so he asked me to write a paper on the Holy Spirit. And I did. I went home and I wrote a paper on the Holy Spirit. And gave it to him. I don't know what happened. He never accepted the Lord. Okay, but you know what? We're not catchers of men. We're fishers of men. You don't always catch the fish. Sometimes the fish gets away for someone else to catch. You know? Just share this with you. It takes a person, on average person, about 8 times to hear a clear presentation of the gospel before they become a Christian. That's the average. I probably heard hundreds of messages, so I skewed the average. And maybe some of you, first time you heard it, boom, you believed it. That's great. Okay? But anyways, I don't know if he accepted the Lord or not. But one thing that he said to me while we were debating, he said, the moment you walked on the job site, I knew you were a Christian. How did he know? Because of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, not spirits. Holy Spirit, singular, indwells me. Yeah, our light shines. And so God had an answer for him. God had an answer for Israel. The fire comes down. The prophets of Baal are exterminated. Okay? And then if you read further on, what happens is that God lifts the drought from Israel. 3.5 years of no rain ends with a storm. Okay? And if you read it, you'll find out that Elijah outruns a chariot. God empowers the prophet to outrun a chariot. Okay? And he does. He outruns the chariot. And he gets to, you know, the capital before Ahab does. But here's the deal. Here's the final deal. Ahab never changed. Ahab didn't change. In fact, later on, God says about Ahab in 1 Kings 21, verses 25 and 26, that he was the most evil of all the kings of Israel. And you know, again, I can't help it, but do you realize that there were 6 kings before him? 6 is the number of man. He was the 7th king of Israel. He completed the evil cycle, and he was the worst of it all. He was the worst king of Israel, bar none. In fact, if you study the book of Revelation, in Revelation chapter 2, his wife gets mentioned. Okay? Her name is Jezebel. Gets mentioned. Ahab never repents. And you know what? Some people will never repent from their sins. And that is sad. Some people will never repent. And they will die in their sins and they will go to hell. That is sad because they don't have to. Lots of people won't. They'll hear the gospel message and they'll repent. Brothers and sisters, we need to listen to God's voice. Maybe we're caught up into some sin that we're struggling with and we need to repent. Maybe our faith is weak and we need to repent. I'm here to tell you, God will pour his fire down upon you. But you know what? Like the bull, the wood, and the stone, be prepared to be consumed by the Almighty. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have consumed my life, because without you, I have nothing. Yes. And it's not that I don't really have nothing, but in the light of you, compared to you, I have nothing. But in you, I have everything. So, Father, I pray, God, that you would help us here at this church, that we would allow ourselves to be living sacrifices, consumed by you to do your will. Please forgive us for our sins and cleanse us from our iniquity. Help us to walk in righteousness, Lord God. Unify our hearts with one another. Give us brotherly love and forgiveness for each other. Lord, we are but flesh, and you are God. And we know that apart from you, we can do nothing, but we can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. Thank you. Thank you, God, for giving us this wonderful truth. Lord, may we rebuild or build up our altar to you in our hearts. And Lord, may you be glorified in all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If you're a listener who doesn't know Jesus Christ, if you're not born again of God's Spirit, today's the day of salvation. Jesus could come back right now, and if he were to come back right now, and if you're not saved, you're going to get left behind, and you're going to have to meet the most horrible person this world has ever seen, the Antichrist. We at First Congregational Church don't want that to happen to you. And so we ask you, come to Jesus, accept him into your heart. And if you would just pray this real simple prayer with me, you can punch your ticket for the rapture on Airline Jesus. So just pray with me. Dear Jesus, I believe that I am a sinner. I believe that you are the Son of God. I ask you to forgive me for my sins, to cleanse me from my iniquities. Come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my God. Be my Savior. I surrender to you. I ask that you would do this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you did that for the first time, happy birthday. Today truly was your day of salvation. One last favor I ask of you. If you could just go and tell a Bible preaching pastor or friend, someone you trust, what you did. Tell them how you accepted Christ into your heart. Because there's something about speaking out what we do that builds up our faith in Jesus. Well, from the rest of us at First Congregational Church, we'll see you next week, and may God bless you all the days of your life.